Well, good evening and welcome to our Tuesday night Bible study here at Bridge Builders Church International. I'm Pastor Darius G. Crayton, and I'm excited to be able to come out here with you tonight to be able to share from the Word of the Lord and give you just a few moments of what I would consider inspiration. I believe God is up to some big things, praise God, and I'm excited to be able to share with you how that I believe you and I can properly position ourselves to be in the place to hear what God is saying and to follow what God is encouraging us to do. So tonight, as you're coming in, please do this favor for me. Like, share, and invite, and know that I'm welcoming all of you from FaceTime, from YouTube, Instagram, or however you may be tuning in tonight. I want you to know that we're thankful and grateful unto God that you've chosen to tune in, and I pray tonight you hear something that will benefit and be a blessing in your life. Again, welcome tonight, and again, I don't have a lot of time. I want to just take just a few moments to instill in you and share some things with you that maybe you've heard before, but maybe you need to hear yet again. So let's pray and let's jump right into it tonight. Father, we thank you for this time together. We thank you for the Word of God, and we thank you for the supernatural power of God that's been made available unto us that we might carry out your will for our lives. And Lord, I pray that there's a supernatural infusion tonight. Oh my God, that we'll begin to, the light bulb comes on, praise God. The switch is flipped, praise God. And that our lives are changed to the glory of Almighty God. So, Father, we thank you tonight that you think through my mind, speak through my vocal cords. None of me, all of you, have your way here tonight and bless your people. And it's in Jesus' name that we pray. And all that agree with that, shout amen. Praise God. Well, listen, I wanted to talk to you about something tonight that I believe is vitally important. And it's something I recall back in Super Bowl Sunday 1982. I preached my first sermon, and my first sermon that I preached was down in Florence, Alabama, at a church. It was the Faith Tabernacle Church. Now it's called Faith Church. But I preached my first sermon there, Super Bowl Sunday, 1982, praise God. Or was it 1992. Yeah, I apologize. But 1992, the thing that I preach is what I want to talk to you about tonight, and it's about hearing the voice of God. And I want you to realize that, you know, we've been talking in this overall series that we're dealing with on Sundays on understanding success, and realize that our success in life truly comes from relationships. And it's our relationship with God, number one. Then we talked about our relationship with our mate and our children. And now we're in a phase in that series talking about the development of our relationships one with another and how important it is for us to show the love of God one to another and to witness one to another. And expressing and sharing the love of God and all that God has done for us through Christ and what Christ has done for us. You know, holistically, he's died for the sins of the world, and individually, where you may have been healed, delivered, saved, and or set free from some demonic forces or whatever the case may be. But we're looking at that. But I wanted to go back and talk a little bit tonight about that number one relationship, and again, that is our relationship with God, and that's the centermost part of our relationship, all of our relationships, and it is the centermost piece for our success in life. It's not about what you have, it's about who you're connected to. And one of the things that I want to say to you tonight is I definitely want you to put yourselves in a position to be able to clearly hear the voice of God, because it is going to be vital for your success in life. I've made this comment once or twice, and that is that everything that I've heard from God and everything I heard and everything that I stepped out and did, it all came to pass just as God had spoken it. And I want you to know tonight, and I'm putting everything on the line when I make this comment, And that is that when you hear the voice of God and step out on what God has instructed you to do, it is guaranteed to work. It always works when you follow the instructions of God. And so with that being said tonight, we've talked to you about how to develop a relationship with God. You know, the Bible says, number one, if you're going to develop a relationship with God, you need to know about him. You know, the Bible in 2 Peter chapter 1 and verse 2, it says that as we gain more knowledge of God and of Jesus Christ, more of God's grace is multiplied in our life along with the peace of God. And so gaining knowledge of God is going to be critical for us. So if we're going to develop a relationship with God, first we start with the Word of God. And, you know, go to John chapter 8. John chapter 8, it's the Word of God that's going to be the key to us developing this relationship with God. And if that's the primary or the first or the most critical relationship in any of our lives, then we need to understand just how important the Word of God is in us gaining new levels of understanding pertaining to who God is. And here's what he says for us in verse 31 of John chapter 8. He says, "Then said Jesus to those Jews which believed on him, he said, if ye continue in my word, then are you my disciples indeed." He's talking here about disciplined ones. And I want to say to you tonight that you and I must begin to discipline ourselves to read the Word of God, to spend time in the Word. He says, when you discipline yourself, what happens? He says, and then you shall know the truth, and the truth that you know, it will make you free, or cause you to be free. Free from what? Free from religion that doesn't work, free from prejudice, free from poverty. It'll cause you to get free from demonic forces. It's the truth of the Word of God that you gain through reading and hearing the Word of God. And so that's one of the ways we can begin to develop our relationship with God is through reading the Word. You know, the Bible also instructs us in 2 Timothy. He instructs us to study the Word. 2 Timothy chapter 3, I think it is, 2 Timothy chapter 2 and verse 15. It says, study to show thyself approved unto God. He's saying, study the Word of God. Don't just read it. You know, many people make a comment and they say, well, the Bible says. Well, you got to be cautious about making that comment, because what you really want to convey to people is what the Bible teaches. You know, you can't just pull a scripture out of context and utilize it for your own good or for the demise of someone else. You want to make sure you're studying the Bible to know what it teaches from Genesis to Revelation, what it teaches as a thread of truth that goes from generation to generation. That's why he says, study to show thyself approved unto God. You're not studying to show yourself approved unto people. Some people want to study so that they can prove to everybody else how many scriptures they know. But it's not how many scriptures you know or have memorized. It's how many of them have you applied to your everyday life, and they are now working on your behalf. So he says, study to show thyself approved unto God, a workman that needeth not be ashamed. Now, we talked about, you know, the work of Christ, and I believe that work is to continue what he started, witnessing, sharing the gospel, preaching the gospel, healing, delivering, doing all of the work of the ministry. He says, a workman that needeth not be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. And so you and I have to begin to not only read the word, but we need to study the word. That means you get your study guides and your Bible references so that you can see what it says from, you know, one generation to another, from one testament to the other testament, and how that all of God's truth comes together, praise God. So that's one way in which we can begin to develop a relationship with God. Why do I need a relationship? And it comes down to me being able to clearly hear the Word of God. Clearly hear the Word of God. Now, secondly, it's through prayer. The Bible in Luke 18:1 says, men ought always to pray and not faint, but always have an opportunity now to hear or converse with God. You know, if there's anybody you're going to talk to throughout the day, it ought to be God. I've always told you about Smith Wigglesworth, and he said that he doesn't pray but 15 minutes at a time, but he doesn't go 15 minutes without prayer. Meaning what? He's always in constant contact with God. That's why the Bible says men ought always to pray. Don't ever give up, cave in, and quit. You have an opportunity to connect with God in prayer and spend time in His presence and be able not only to pray to God, but also hear from God. You know, the Bible says supplications and intercession. You know, supplications is when I can pray and ask God for something, but also when I'm praying, I'm interceding for someone else. But then when I get through with my part of prayer, I then want to listen. I want to take some time to hear what God may be saying back to me. Prayer is not just a dialogue or a monologue, but it is a dialogue. It is where the two are coming together to become one. This is where we can get closer to God and God can get closer to us. Amen? You know, we sometimes think prayer is just a laundry list of things that we want, but prayer should be really an intimate time spent with God to be able to be in His presence. You know, when I enter His presence with thanksgiving and I let the joy of the Lord be my strength. I enter in praising and thanking Him for who He is. I uplift His name. But then at the same time, as I'm, you know, making declarations, as I'm making requests of God, then I want to hear, what does God have in store for me? Prayer. Men ought always to pray. Why? Because this is a way to further develop a relationship with God and be in a position to clearly hear the voice of God. What's number three? Number three, we talked about how important it is to be in church. You know, the Bible says or teaches that we should not forsake the assembling of ourselves together with the saints. Now, I know we've gone through a pandemic and people have been social distancing and mask covering and, you know, staying away and getting vaccinated and, you know, whatever you've chosen, that's a choice that you've had to make, whether to be vaccinated or not, whether to wear a mask or not. But again, the Bible encourages us to do what? Assemble ourselves. And I'm excited to see some of you starting to come back to church, be a part of the congregation, be in the midst of things when it's actually happening. Nothing wrong with you viewing it on Facebook or Instagram, there's something about getting up and being a part of the congregation. You exercise all of the restraints or all of the caution that you need for your conviction as it relates to where you are in relationship to this pandemic. But I believe it's vital for us to come together. There's something that happens in a corporate environment where the supernatural power of God shows up on our behalf as well. And so you do your part to assemble and be in the house of God. Why is that so powerful? Because of what God said. He said that I'll give you pastors after my own heart. Praise God. Hey, Jeremiah chapter 3. Let's look at that just real quick. Jeremiah chapter 3 and verse 15. God says, I will give you pastors according to mine own heart, which shall feed you with knowledge and understanding. I believe not only do you get knowledge, but you get the wisdom of God. You get understanding of the scriptures, how to rightly divide things, how to be able to apply those things in your practical life when you have a man and or woman of God, a pastor that's going to be there to teach you, train you, share with you. Now, that can come from an apostle, from a prophet, from an evangelist, as well as a teacher. But the pastor is that gift that has been given to the body of Christ to actually be in the local church, to be there to teach you, to train you, to prepare you, to develop you, to go to these next levels. And I realize that pastors are important. We cannot neglect the other gifts, ministry gifts, the apostle, the prophet, the evangelist, and teacher, because they also can be pastors themselves. But realize that as a pastor or as a congregant or as a member of the body of Christ, I believe everyone needs to have a local church that they are connected to, because God has fitly placed us in the body where it has pleased him. And you need to find out where that is for you so that you can assemble yourselves together with other saints, so that iron can sharpen iron, so that you don't get off by yourself somewhere drinking grape juice and end up, you know, off the beaten path. You know, it's dangerous to be alone by yourself for too long, because you start talking to yourself and only hearing your voice, and it may be a voice that can lead you astray. That's why you need to be around others that can provide you with what? Knowledge of the scriptures, wisdom pertaining to them, and understanding of how they apply to your everyday life. So your assembly, coming to church, is something that properly positions you to be able to hear the voice of the Lord. Now, we realize that number four in developing our relationship with God, it's centered around fellowship. You know, I'm coming to church to hear the word of God, but I'm really listening for a word from God. Now, the Bible says in Romans chapter 10 and verse 17, faith cometh by what? Hearing, and hearing by the word of God. So I'm coming to hear the word, but I'm listening for a word. So that, number four, when I'm fellowshipping with other believers, and again, we may be distancing a little bit, we may not fellowship as much, but wherever there's opportunities for us to fellowship, we do that in the safest manner possible so that we can rub off on one another, iron sharpening iron. You know, someone else that may be operating in a different gift of maybe dreams and visions can be able to share with you maybe what God had shared with them. The Bible says, iron sharpeneth iron, so a man sharpeneth the countenance of his friend. And that's Proverbs 27:17. So again, you need to understand the value of fellowshipping with one another, because God can speak to us through multiple vehicles. He can speak through the word. He can speak to us in prayer. He can speak to us through the pastor. And or he may be able to speak to us through another member of the body, someone else that's there in the church that operates in a particular gift. That can be very beneficial to you to be able to hear the voice of God. You know, I never forget this one incident that happened with me when we were at World Changers. Man, there had been a number of things that had transpired in my life that were just kind of chaotic. You know, our home had been broken into, and you know, my family was with me, and I went to a meeting, and I was sitting in church, and I was ready to just quit. Like, this is just too much. And I never forget that God used an usher to minister to me, and that woman said one thing to me, changed my entire life. And boy, every time I see her, I love on her, man. She was just used of God in my life. So you never know who God will use or who God can use, and that's anybody. So you and I need to always, again, be in fellowship. Just imagine if I had been off by myself and not at church, not in fellowship with other believers. I may have made a drastic decision that could have altered the, you know, destiny of my life. But because that young lady was in place and God was willing to use her, or she was willing to be used of God, spoke a word into my life that changed my life forever. And then, you know, the latter part of us helping or developing this relationship with God is us being in a position to minister to others. Just like she was used to minister to me, why would we not be in a position to be able to be minister to other people? And that's kind of what we're talking about now in our overall series on Sunday, is about reaching out, winning souls, changing lives, being able to be used of God to witness, to minister the gospel, to share the good news of Jesus Christ, and to be in a position just to encourage people, man. You know, there are a lot of people that need just encouraging, and sometimes they may be right in your family, right in your own house, right at in your own church, or it may be somebody on your job, but we got to be ready and prepared to do what? Minister to others. I think that's a part of us developing our relationship with God, because the more we're able to hear, the more we're able to do. Now, why is this hearing so critical? Because of what it provides for you. But before I go there, I want to go over to Psalms 29 and verse 3. I want you to know that hearing the voice of God is not as hard as maybe you think. I think hearing the voice of God is all about being properly positioned, being in a place in the Word, in prayer, in church, fellowshipping with other believers, or just out there witnessing the good news of Jesus Christ. It puts you in a position to clearly hear the voice of God. Look at verse 3 of Psalms 29. It says, "The voice of the Lord is upon the waters. The God of glory thundereth. The Lord is upon many waters." I want you to know that when I read verse 3, what I hear is that God, number one, is always speaking. God is always speaking. And when I look at it, says the voice of the Lord is upon the waters. God is always speaking. His voice is always out there. But you and I need to be tuned in to the right frequency to be able to hear the voice of the Lord. He says the God of glory thundereth. In other words, it is a voice that it now will shake you. It's a voice that will get your attention, praise God, if you ever get tuned in. You know, I always use this analogy. There are three major stations in our area, radio stations. One is WEUP, and it's where you go to hear rap or R&B. There is WZYP. That's where you go to hear pop music, you know, some of the latest pop artists. And then there's another channel, 90.1 WZY. It's a W. I'm not sure exactly what the call letters are, but it's a Christian station. But then what about WORD, the Word? That's the station we need to be tuned into so that we can hear the voice of God, not rap, not R&B, not just Christian music, but I want to hear a word from God for my life. He's always out there speaking. And then the Bible says that the Lord is upon many waters. Or in other words, there are many ways in which God can get to you, or that you can hear his voice. Again, it may be through the Word, through prayer, through the pastor. It may come from a friend in fellowship. It may come from a prophetic word, praise God. It may come from a dream or vision that someone had pertaining to you. But there are many waters in which God can allow you to hear his voice. And then verse 4 says, "The voice of the Lord is powerful. The voice of the Lord is full of majesty." I want you to know that when you hear the voice of God, it is the power of God that comes with it. The power of God to change and rearrange everything in your life. The power of God to change every situation that may exist. Hearing his voice and following those instructions will always bring about supernatural change for you. And
I'm saying all of this tonight. Why? Because I believe we're in a time and we're in a season where you and I are going to need to hear the voice of God very clearly, because every step you take is going to be a step toward your destiny in life. And you, in this season, can't afford to have missteps. You can't be in the wrong place at the wrong time. No, you need to be right where God wants you to be, and you need to hear his voice very clearly. I'll give you more insight in just a moment. But he says, the voice of the Lord is powerful. The voice of the Lord is full of majesty. Why is hearing his voice so vital? And why are you even talking about this tonight? Go with me over to Job. Go to Revelation chapter 1, because I want you to hear the magnitude of what happens when you hear the voice of the Lord. And this is something that all of us need to be aware of. You know, the Bible encourages us in Revelation, since we're there, Revelation chapter 4 and verse 1. Let's look at that first, and then we'll go over to Revelation 1. But Revelation 4 and 1, it says, after this I looked, and behold, a door was opened in heaven, and the first voice which I heard was as it were a trumpet talking with me. He says, the first voice that I heard was as of a trumpet talking with me, which said, come up hither. What is he saying? Come up to a place where you and I are in the presence of God, where you and I are in the Word of God, where you and I are fellowshipping with God. He says, come up hither, and I will show thee things which must be hereafter. I will show you. He said he heard a voice, said, come up hither. Come get in this place with me. I want to show you some things which must be hereafter. I'm telling you that God is wanting to properly position us right now in this season to hear his voice, to know what the hereafter is, to know the direction that we need to move in. You know, there's one thing to be anointed, another thing to have vision, but yet you also need direction. You can hear the voice of God, you can have vision, you know, but if you don't have direction, folks, how many of you know you're still lost? Praise God. And so go back now to Revelation chapter 1. Let's look at verse 9. Verse 9, Revelation 1 and 9. See, hearing the voice of God is critical, and I want you to have divine direction. I want you to clearly hear the voice of God, and I want you to have enough faith and enough tenacity to step out on it and see it come to pass for you. Everything that I've done in life that's been successful came as a result of me hearing the voice of God and then stepping out to do what I heard. Now, why is that? Here's what. John, Revelation 1 and 9. I, John, who also am your brother and companion in tribulation, and in the kingdom and patient of Jesus Christ, was in the isle that is called Patmos. Now, John had been ostracized. John had been put on this island called Patmos, and he says, why? For the word of God. In other words, John had been doing what I'm encouraging you and I to do. That is witnessing, praise God, sharing the gospel, sharing the truth of the word of God. And as a result of it, the religious people put him aside. They ostracized him, put him on this island called Patmos because of the word. And the Bible says, and for the testimony of Jesus Christ. So here he's out here sharing the gospel, testifying about Jesus Christ. And as a result, he got kicked out, praise God. But he says, on this isle called Patmos, in this place all by himself, the Bible says, I was in the spirit, or John said, I was in the spirit on the Lord's day. I was in the spirit, not in the flesh. He wasn't just depending on his natural, senses. He had now shifted into the realm of the spirit. He says, I was in the spirit on the Lord's day, and what happened? I heard behind me a great voice as of a trumpet. You know, it's amazing that here in Revelations 4, Revelations 1, when they heard the voice of God, it was like a loud trumpet. It was a major sound. Remember, we just showed you, the voice of the Lord thundereth, praise God. It's something that will awake you. It's something that will shake you from your inner core. I never forget when I heard from God about quitting my job and selling out following Dr. Dollar. It was like an explosion that went off on the inside of me. That's the only way I can explain it. But it shook my whole being, praise God. And that's what I'm telling you. God is wanting to have an encounter with you. God is wanting your life to be interrupted and erupt in you what he has in store for you. And I want you to get yourself in a position to be able to clearly hear, get rid of all clutter, praise God. Anything or anybody that may be cluttering up your life, it's time now to get rid of it. Why? Because God is wanting to speak to you, not in some still small voice. He may come that way, but I believe something that will shake you from your core, praise God, and you will know that it is God. He said it was like the sound of a trumpet, praise God. And what did he say? He said, I am Alpha and I am Omega. I am the first and the last. I am the beginning and I am the end. There is none greater than me. I am that I am, praise God. But this, what really got me, is the next comment. Ooh, glory. I believe the Delta virus has been taken care of by Alpha and Omega, praise God. But he says, what thou seest, my God. He says, what thou seest, write it in a book and send it unto the seven churches which are in Asia, unto Ephesus, Smyrna, unto Pergamos, unto Sardis, and under Philadelphia, and then under Laodicea, Thyatira, I think that's how it's pronounced. But anyway, send it to the seven churches. You get the message. But the point is what John heard, Jesus said, now, what you see, what he heard became vision. What he heard became insight, wisdom, revelation, understanding of what it was to be. And he said, what you hear, what you see, he said, I heard something. He says, but what you see now, the vision that has come to you, write that vision down and send it to the seven churches. And we can read the recordings of what he sent to the seven churches. That's something that he heard that turned into a vision. It turned into a redemptive revelation of who God was. It literally gave him understanding of that which was to come. It gave him understanding so that he had something to hold on to. And I'm telling you right now, there are many that are sad, depressed, lonely. Some people are trying to figure out, what is this life really all about? Some may even be contemplating taking your life. Some may be thinking, well, I've already reached this pinnacle. No, baby. Listen, what you've learned so far is just, it got you to where you are. But what God has in store for your future is greater than anything you've ever seen, anything you've ever heard, and anything you could ever even imagine. The vision that God is trying to reveal to you is going to be largely based on your ability to hear, and your ability to hear is going to be based on you properly positioning yourselves to hear his voice. It requires time in his presence through prayer, through the word, through church services. I'm telling you, folks, many people think, oh, that church stuff is old. No, listen, it's still where God has decided for his people to gather and for him to show up and show out with miracles, signs, and wonders. Yeah, he'll be doing some of those outside of the church, but there are some things that are going to happen in the church that you and I need to be privy to. Things are going to happen in the church to prepare you to go outside the church. And I'm telling you, folks, I've seen it in vision and just as clear as day, people running back to church flooding the churches, and they're falling on their faces, wanting a word from God, needing to hear the voice of God, and needing a touch from God. You and I got to get prepared for this. I'm telling you, get ready, get ready, get ready. It's coming, and it's coming quicker than you and I can get prepared for. So I'm telling you now in advance, be ready, praise God. Why is this so vital? I'll finish up here. I just had a few minutes. I wanted to share Proverbs 29, verse 18. Now, for those of you that are bridge builders, especially tonight, you need to understand this is a foundational scripture for this entire ministry. Our ministry was developed based on this particular scripture. He says in Proverbs 29, 18, where there is no vision. Where does vision come? According to Revelations 1, it comes from hearing the voice of God. It comes from hearing the voice of God. But where there is no vision, there's no redemptive revelation of God, in one translation, where you're not hearing the voice of God. He says the people perish. They die out. They have no essence. He says, but he that keepeth the law, talking about the word of God, especially the word pertaining to God's amazing grace, happy is he, fortunate, blessed, and enviable will he be. You got to realize that God is trying to set you and I in a position to attract the world to us, not us being attracted to the things of the world. God's trying to raise his people up. God's trying to bless you. God's trying to position you so that the world will begin to look at you and say, oh my God, I want to be just like them. I need to have what they have. And so God's about to infuse your life with some supernatural manifestation of wealth and increase and positioning in the world system so that the world can see that the kingdom of God is much brighter than the world. I'm telling you, boy, it got light. It was dark in Egypt, but it was light in Goshen. And I'm telling you, there's about to be a transformation. There's about to be a light switch go on where there's going to be light in the kingdom, but it's going to be darkness in all other areas of the world. This world system, I can tell you without a shadow of a doubt, it's dying. Why? Because the scripture says that the kingdoms of our God are going to overshadow and overtake the kingdoms of this world. That's why you don't need to be dependent on anything pertaining to the world system. You need to get your trust on God. In God, on God, you need to trust in him. Why? Because if you don't have that as a foundation in your life will crumble. I'm telling you, folks, you got to have a redemptive revelation. It comes from hearing. You need to know what the future holds, what the plans and the purposes are. And God says through hearing his voice and by having the Holy Ghost, you'll know what's about to come up. He says he's given us the Holy Spirit to let us know what's to come to pass in the future. And I'm telling you, God is up to something big. You need to properly position yourself to hear his voice and so that you now can step into this next dimension of life and begin to live life in abundance to the full until life overflows. I'm telling you, God is up to something. And I don't know if you've seen it yet. I don't know if you've had dreams about it yet, visions about it, but God's about to reveal to you what he wants to have in your life. And God's about to, he really wants to tell you that he wants you and I to be the billionaires and the trillionaires in this earth realm. God wants to know, can I trust you with the little? Because if I can trust you with what you got, I can trust you with even more. And God's wanting to flood your life, not only with his wisdom and knowledge and understanding, but he wants to flood our lives with his wealth and material blessings. And you and I be the landowners. You and I be the ones that are controlling what's happening in this earth realm, not the wicked. That's why he says the wealth of the wicked is laid up for the just. So you and I, as the righteousness of God, need to get ready for this wealth transfer that I talked about. But you got to clearly hear the voice of God. Follow his instruction. He's going to lead you and guide you into all truth, spiritual blessings, and he's going to lead you into this wealth flow that I believe God has in store for us. So now, I've said quite a bit tonight. Hopefully some of it resonates with you. But more than anything, position yourself to hear the voice of God, because what you hear will give you vision, and that vision is going to determine the success that you have in this life. And I'm telling you, God has something great in store for you. Amen. I hope you heard something tonight that bless you. Like, share, invite, and encourage others to go back, listen to this. It'll position them to have the greater levels of success that I believe God has for his people. Amen. We love you tonight, man. Listen, real quick, I want you to have an opportunity to, number one, get born again, receive the baptism of the Holy Spirit, join us in ministry, connect with us in any shape, form, or fashion that you can. And also, I want to give you an opportunity to sow tonight. But first of all, let's do this. If you're here tonight, you're tapped in, tuned in, locked in, and you're not born again, I want you to make Jesus the Lord of your life. It's a simple process. Just repeat after me in prayer. Say, Father God, I come tonight repenting of my sins, inviting you into my life. As a matter of fact, I choose Jesus Christ as my Lord and personal Savior. And by faith, I declare that I am saved. I believe in my heart that you raised him from the dead, and I am saved. Praise God. I say to you, if you repeated that simple prayer, welcome to the family of God. But that's not enough. You and I, we all need the Holy Ghost. It is the promise of the Spirit of God. That's where John was in the Spirit when he heard the voice of God that turned into a vision. And we know vision is important for our lives. So again, let's get filled with the Holy Ghost by simply asking God to fill us as born-again believers. Say this with me. Say, Father God, as a born-again believer, I ask you to fill me with your Holy Spirit. By faith, I believe it, and by faith, I receive it in Jesus' name. That's a simple process, but the power of God now dwells on the inside of you, and you have the ability to speak in tongues. You have the ability to worship God in spirit and in truth, and I encourage you tonight, if that's you, just let us know. Go to this website, bbci.liveonline@gmail.com. Give us your name, your contact information, and we'll have someone contact you. Send you a free ebook, praise God, and explain salvation, baptism of the Holy Spirit. And if you want to join and connect with us, let us know. I want to connect with Bridge Builders. I believe this is a place where my life can be transformed and I can change forever. Amen. So let us know, man. I want to be your pastor. I love you. I want to reach out. I want to win some souls. I want to change some lives. But more than anyone, I want to be there to teach you, train you, and direct you, and develop you into all that God has in store for your life. Last but not least, before we get out of here tonight, let's take this opportunity to honor God in the area of our giving. You know, your giving will always determine the level of your living. And when you begin to give right, how many know you also begin to live right? So I want to give you an opportunity tonight to sow a bountiful seed so that you can receive a bountiful harvest. We got Super Sunday coming up on the 24th. I want you to go ahead and sow your Super Sunday seed. We're putting faith pressure, praise God, on our facility acquisition, our facility upgrades, on Vision 120, on staffing, and everything else that we're believing God for. We're putting faith pressure to believe to see those things come to pass now as it relates to where God has us, because I believe he's preparing us for a great harvest. He said that the harvest is plenteous, but the laborers are few. But God's about to send us the laborers to go get the rest of the harvest. And I believe it's big, praise God. So sow your seed tonight. Sow for Super Sunday as well. Believe God for, a minimum of $1,000. But man, some of you will be sowing at $5 or $10, or wherever the Lord, whatever the Lord is leading you to sow. But man, we want you to give big, and we're going to utilize that to just honor God and be a blessing to the kingdom and set things in order so that we can accomplish everything that he's called us to accomplish. Amen. Those opportunities are out there. You can go to our website at bbci.org. Hit the donate button. You can use the Tithely app, T-I-T-H-E.L-Y. You also can text to give by texting the word give to 256-670-1750. And so utilize all of those avenues to give, and the cash apps are available as well. $Pastor Crayton with the number 9 and $Alicia Crayton. Those are all available for you tonight. And we love you. Thank God for you. And we believe that the best is yet to come. I add my faith concerning you and your seed tonight. And I declare every seed sown, God will multiply and bring forth a greater level of harvest. Know that I love you. Thank God for you. Don't forget, tomorrow night, 7:30 p.m., we're right back out here. Same bat time, same bat channel. 7:30 p.m. tomorrow night, and we'll look forward to seeing you with more wisdom and revelation from God's Word. God bless you. We love you. Have a great night, and know that Jesus is Lord. And all you're getting, get understanding so you can continue to bridge the gap between religion and reality. Have a great night.